I was saying, right? Everything you said was the absolute truth. Mm. Your cue action was going in and out.
Yeah.
You were really struggling to get it. You weren't lying. You weren't being obtuse.
No.
And we saw it more and more as the tournament went on. It was blatantly obvious it was clicking in and out. Mm. What was the tech? I'm going to ask you about snooker, massive departure
here.
What changed to get those seven frames in a row? Did something click? Did you change something?
Yeah, well, I normally I go for a run in the morning, but I just thought, right, this morning I had to go on a practice table for an hour. After last night, I was completely, like, unable to put balls together. You know, I couldn't hit any solid shots. Kyron was really, you know, striking it well, scoring well. And for me to get four frames, it was only because he potted the blue and potted the red, fouled, unlucky. And the other frame, he missed the red. Otherwise, I lose him two frames as well. And I should have really been behind. So I thought, I've got out of jail 10-7. I've now owe it to myself to get on the practice table and try and find... Just try and find a slot or a swing technique or a swing fault to go into this afternoon session with. And I messed around with my grip and I found something which could I could hold the cue a little bit online. I could hold my finish a bit better. And it just gave me a bit of confidence to go out there and be able to compete, you know, because that's all you want to do is compete, you know. And it would have been horrible for me to not have made a game of it, you know, because, you know, that's what people want to see, you know.
You've had those moments six times now where you hit that one shot that you know wins you a world title. The first time you did it way back against Higgins, the two times you did it against Carter and so on and so on. Does it still feel the same? What goes on inside your body when you go, oh, it's mine again?
It's weird because I think, like, mentally you train yourself to stay in the moment so much, you know, never to get too far ahead because, you know, the minute you start thinking about making speeches and what am I going to say to this one and that one, I've missed game ball and thought, what have I done, you know? So, you know, I've worked with Steve Peters and, you know, we had 3 months ago, I said, look, I really want to give it a good go and I haven't really worked that closely with you, Steve, although we're friends and he's like a father figure, such a lovely human being and we've always been friends. But I said, like, let's really connect. So we were doing a lot of Zoom and FaceTime because of the lockdown and, you know, I had a few mental thoughts that I could carry with me. So every time I felt like it was getting a bit out of shape, I kind of just went back to what we were working on and it just kept me present. And I just, like, some of them sessions where I weren't too good and I wasn't in the groove and I wasn't finding that slot and I wasn't penetrating the ball as well, I was able to not sabotage, basically, and just stay in the match and recover from the next session.
And it's exactly what you've told me standing here as a pundit.
Yeah.
Two things. Respect the game because it'll catch you otherwise. And the other thing you've always said, it's played between the ears. The 6 inches between the ears. And if you're not happy off the table, Ronnie, it's not, especially with your 100-mile-an-hour brain, it's not going to be happy on the table. Yeah. It's going to be torrid. Yeah. It's going to be like a jail rather than a profession.
Yeah.
So that all ties in perfect because the last 7 months have been a really calm period for you in the head.
Like I said, you know, it's very important to get that balance right, to feel competitive because you don't want to be too relaxed. Sometimes you need that little bit of fire in your belly and it's okay to kind of show that emotion sometimes, but then you have to kind of box it, put it away and go, right, we're here to focus on a job and do what we've got to do. So, yeah, you know, I've just tried to, you know, like I said, even before, like every match that I've come to play when I'm wearing my suit, I've not gone on a practice table. I've got my phone out, I've put my Sky app on, I've watched a bit of Honey Falls and also a bit of Storage Wars and just enjoyed that. Because that's the worst bit, you know, when you're waiting to play. So I thought, if I can make that part as enjoyable as possible, don't need to practice. You've done years and years of it. I built, you know, my build-up was good coming here. So, you know, I found ways to kind of get through the moments where the mind can wander because I've got a very overactive brain.
Absolutely. He dares wins. That's what they say. do you know when your pictures pop up on your phone from years ago and it's a bit embarrassing?
Yeah.
Well, this is it in overdrive, right? They're great moments for you. But when you put them all together, I'm probably going to have to get you to explain some of the haircuts. So this is after 9 times of asking, by the way. This is against John Higgins, 2014. Yeah. Well, talk me through that haircut.
Oh, that's a blinder, that one, isn't it? I don't know where that one come from. I must have been in some lockdown for that to go that long.
Two on the bounce here against Alan Carter, of course, 2008. And then the first of your back-to-back.
Yeah, 2012. That was never meant to happen, really. I never expected to get another. Mm-hmm. I was just my game was all over the gaff. And then the following year, but I put it down to Steve Peters, really, you know, because I probably wouldn't have, you know, I don't know. I think for me, it's been a big change in the mental side of it.
Yeah.
I haven't always applied myself and played all the tournaments and whatever, but I've always stuck on to, you know, trying to work that side of it. And if I have gone to tournaments, I'm always prepared, but just probably didn't play enough to be. as good as some of the other guys have been, you know, winning the tournaments.
I think we have to go back to Ray Reardon for an older winner in the 70s. It would have been his last one, obviously, because you get older. And we see you there, the Silver Fox, as we might have to start calling you soon. But this is different, isn't it, because you're fit?
Yeah, I feel very fit at the moment. I've done 17 weeks of running, the first time in 10 years. I'm able to go out and do any, you know, I can do anything up to 10 miles, been doing like 40 miles a week. So I'm in a half-decent shape, and I hope to get in even better shape, you know, because the running has been fantastic for the mental health. I can eat a little bit more and not worry about piling on the pans. It's just like my friend said, he said he's your midfielder, you know, when he's on the pitch. And you're running, everything else seems to kind of fall into place. And I think that's key for me. You know?
Does having this, being back up, I think I put you number two in the world as far as I was looking earlier. Not great at huge amounts of money. I've never had them. Does having this, being the proud owner of the most famous trophy again in snooker, bought by Joe Davis, whose book has been inspiring you.
Yeah, of course.
Does this change anything for the next year, or will we see you pick and choose your tournaments and get that life balance?
No, yeah, I don't know if this means I don't have to qualify for the overseas events. So if I don't have to qualify for the overseas events, then I'll probably play more overseas events because, you know, like the big tournaments are in China and I love going to Germany and Austria, but I just don't want to have to go to Barnsley to have to get through the qualifiers. So, you know, I haven't been number one, I haven't been world champion, so I haven't played in them tournaments for a while. So I think the key is to try and play there and play more in China, because it's come towards the end of my career and I just think that's a great place to sort of, you know, apply your trade, really, you know, because, you know, it's just, I just enjoy my time out there. Well, so, you know, I won't be playing anymore, you know, if I want that home balance. And, you know, I play snooker because I choose to, not because I have to now. So it's important that I just play it when I feel like it, really.
Your first ever final was against John Higgins, right? We're talking about, as you said earlier, win four, you're a great.
Yeah.
If there was one final you could pick now, if you were to be able to compete to this to win a seventh equal Stephen Hendry, would you like it to be against Mark Williams? Would you like it to be against John Higgins? Would you like it to be against someone who's breathing that air?
Listen, there's so many players. I mean, I love playing Williams because we grew up as a kid playing each other, and we know each other. He knows me better than I know myself, and I know him better than he knows himself. So when we play each other, it's like a poker player. You can spot if they're bluffing or not, you know. So Higgins, another great player. I probably wouldn't want to play John because if he's on, he's just too good. You know what I mean? So I'd probably go for someone like, you know, Selby would be good. I mean, because he's a real heavyweight player. He's got the pedigree. And, you know, you beat someone like Selby, you know you've won. You know, you've got to win them matches. So, listen, why not? Why not bring Joe Davis back? Let me have a go at Joe.
Oh, no, don't go on about Joe again. We get into it saying. But I think the way for you to win a seventh of this, and obviously feel free to disagree, is for you, for it not to be your focus. I think that's how we see Ronnie lift the seven. The Ronnie that goes back to playing everywhere probably isn't going to lift that, because by the time you get here, Shredsville. You know?
Do you know what? I've realised I really struggle with the mayhem and the crowds being at this tournament. I just thought it was just the pressure of the World Championships. It wasn't anything to do with that, because up until the final, I was playing at home. Although we was playing a Crucible, I didn't have to put up with all... Not put up with it, but it just affected me, you know, and I just couldn't relax because I was just felt like I was just being... I had to lock myself away, basically.
If you don't mind that, because I don't want it to come across in a different way, because I can understand it. You're very introverted away from the thing. Your solace and your peace and quiet is needed for your mental health. Yeah. And I don't like it when people pick up on it in another way. Mm. We talk about mental health a little bit more now, but not as much. You find your peace in quiet.
Yeah.
So any period of 2 weeks, whether it be family staying, whether it be a tournament, messes with the head.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, you're right. But I noticed a difference when they let a crowd in and there's people at stage door and like people in the crowd. And although I get a lot of support, believe me, I'm better off without the crowd, to be honest with you, because it's too much pressure. I feel the weight of them wanting me to do well. And up until the final, I just felt, I felt a bit of pressure, nice nerves, but not to the point where it just... And then for the final, I don't know, like, we both had our supporters, but I preferred it when it was empty, to be honest with you. But that's just me. I just don't deal with feeling that I have to deliver and perform. You know, it's hard. It's hard to do that, you know?
You've thought about sabotaging next year. You could use the money you've won to buy all the tickets.
No, listen, it's like what Layla came down yesterday and we were hanging out, having breakfast now, and she went, right, today, I'm not seeing you. Get on what you got to do. Da, da, da. And she knows. She knows that you need to be in that mindset. Yeah. So it's good that she was able to, you know, and she was right. And today I just got up, done my practice, done what I had to do. And, you know, she like Mark Williams, she knows me better than I know myself. Do you know what I mean? So sometimes I need to be told, do you know what I mean? Because I do everything wrong. Yeah. I even phoned Steve Peters out. I said, Steve, I've got like 140 messages. I've only got 10 tickets. I feel really bad. What should I do? He went, don't answer none of them. Just focus on your snooker and your real friends will understand and, you know, you can catch up with them afterwards. But me, I just want to, like, make sure everyone's all right. And, you know, you've got to focus on the job in hand sometimes.
Final question. And the fact he works for us is brilliant. When would you ever keep somebody who's just won the World Championship for this long? It's brilliant. He gets paid for this as well. It's crazy. What's your proudest moment of the 2 weeks and a few days? What is the moment where you go, that's the bit I'll pull out? And I won't allow you to have the win, you know, like...
Yeah, I'll take that out.
But what's the moment you go, wow, I'm so pleased about
you? I think the point against when I was 16, 14 down against Selby, and I hung on and hung on. And when I got back to 13-all, my thought was, I'm just pleased I've made a bit of a match of it and I've made the scoreboard respectable. And I thought, 13-all, if I get beat 17-13, yeah, it ain't great, but no one can say I took a drub in. Selby's like one of the best match player, if you like. And to produce three frames like I did at that time, that snooker god stuff, you know, that was just, you know. But again, you know, I was present, I was doing all I could, I left everything out there, and I think that was just someone saying, look, there's your chance, there's a bit of form. You know, and I was there to take the advantage. So I think that was probably the biggest highlight of this tournament, if you like.
Yeah. Well, listen, I'm sure I can get a clap from the room for the first time ever. There's people there. Ladies and gentlemen, 2020 World Snooker Champion. Take the trophy with you, Ronnie. Ronnie O'Sullivan. Take the trophy with you, my friend.
Oh, so I take it with you. Well done.
I think she's like, no worries. Good guy.